for coming, and to our viewers via live stream, greetings. Catherine and I would like to welcome you to an evening of lesser-known greatest hits by the most often performed operatic composer of our time, Giuseppe Verdi. You just heard In Solitaria Stanza, or In Her Solitary Room, a melancholy song of tragedy and suffering of a type so popular in the early Romantic period. It is the third of six romances that Verdi published in 1838 at the age of 25, which he often used as calling cards while he was an aspiring young composer studying and trying to find work in Milan. But let's back up to 1813, where on October 9th, a baby is born to Carlo and Luigia Verdi, innkeepers in the tiny hamlet of Le Roncole, 3 miles outside the little market town of Busseto, in the centrally located province of Parma, which was at that time a part of Napoleon's kingdom of Italy. French was the official language at that moment, so the newborn was officially registered as Joseph Fortunato François, instead of Giuseppe Fortunino Francesco, soon to be known as Peppino by his family. It was a time of political uncertainty throughout the entire Italian route, with the French followers of Napoleon controlling the northwest and central Italy, the Austrians under the Habsburgs controlling northeastern Italy, including Venice and Milan, and many other splintered city-states controlled by various aristocratic and religious powers. Little survives of Peppino's life as a child except legend, including the report that when armies swept through the area in 1814, his mother was forced to hide in the church belfry with her one-year-old son, praying that he wouldn't cry. Verdi himself reported later in his life, "I just accepted that I looked and bubbled at my mom." 2 years later, Verdi's only sibling, a sister, Giuseppa Francesca, was born, whom he grew to adore. She was to pass away at the age of 17. Italian families are usually very close, and although Verdi was to leave home by age 10 in order to advance his studies, once his fortune was made, he took care to set his family up in ease and comfort. By the age of 4, Peppino's youthful precocity emerges, eagerly nurtured by an ambitious father and encouraged through a sustained, sophisticated, and elaborate formal education to come. He began private lessons in Latin and Italian when he was still 3 years old, before his 4th birthday. Verdi's father was to buy his son a wretched spinet, highly unusual for a rural Italian youth to own his own instrument, which Verdi was to keep his entire life. He was a solemn, reserved boy to whom music meant everything, and by age 8, he had become the paid organist of the local parish in his hometown. 8 years, think of an 8 year old as your paid organist in your church. Amazing. By age 10, Giuseppe was sent to the Ginnasio, the upper school for boys in Busseto, where he gradually became known as the boy who slept little and worked constantly. At age 12, he entered the music school and was eventually taken in by Antonio Barezzi, a well-to-do merchant with 4 daughters and 2 sons. Verdi was to become a part of their household, even giving piano and voice lessons to Barezzi's children, especially their daughter, Margherita. Their family forte piano, a Viennese Tomaszek, upon which Verdi practiced and composed, still exists. And here is my daughter, Eden, playing that instrument on our visit to the Barezzi Museum in Busseto. Just a warning, I don't think they have tuned it since Peppino played it, so, but here it is. Thank you.
themselves.
Indentations made by their fingers.
Made by various fingers and by even.
Good?
And the big God, Lord, to her guide. Eden, where are you? Where is you? Stand up for a second. A bit out of tune. But what an honor to have played an instrument upon which the maestro himself had taught and composed. It was at the Casa Varese that Verdi was thrust into the heart of Busetto's musical life. By age 13, he composed many works for the church and the Philharmonic Society of Busetto, for which he often served as pianist and conductor. However, as the years passed, it was clear that he needed more training in his profession that could be found in this rather small town. He had fallen in love with Varese's eldest daughter, Margherita, and wanted to be in a position to marry her. Therefore, Papa Varese thought it expedient to advance the necessary money to the 18-year-old Giuseppe for 4 years of study away at the Milan Conservatoire. But Giuseppe was denied admission for being too old at age 18. Even so, his musical gifts were recognized by one of the examiners, and arrangements were made for Verdi to study privately in Milan, with Varese agreeing to pick up the almost doubled cost thereof. To his good fortune, Verdi chose as his professor of composition a former member of the orchestra at La Scala, a connection that was to prove invaluable in the coming years. Through a period of hard work, successes and failures, the now 26-year-old Verdi found himself married to his beloved Margherita, the father of a one-year-old daughter, Virginia, a newborn son, Icilio, and invited to soon make his debut at La Scala, Milan. Oberto, il Conte di San Bonifacio, was the vehicle, a composition that was 4 years in the making, and which took its title from the bass rather than the tenor. The compositional style was, for the most part, what has been referred to as Code Rossini, meaning aria, followed by duet, followed by an ensemble, and a finale, and arias, which took the form of three sections, a cantilena or slow arioso, a tempo media of chorus or other characters, followed by a rousing cavaletta, oftentimes two strophes, in which a singer could embellish the music. Here's an example. The story of Oberto concerns itself, just a moment. Now it concerns itself with honor, a subject that would possess Verdi throughout his career. In this scene, we find the aging Count Oberto in the forest, awaiting his young rival in order to fight a duel to avenge his betrayed daughter's honor. E tardan ancora from Oberto.
Thank you.
Sento In those days, operas were never complete until they were performed. And Oberto, which created a mild sensation, received 13 additional performances at its premiere. The young composer was invited to write 3 more operas for La Scala, and at least one fairly objective observer, reviewer, and at least one fairly objective reviewer, thank you, believed that Verdi might look forward to a significant career. However, a series of catastrophic events was to befall the new composer. Shortly prior to the premiere of Oberto, Verdi's 16-month-old daughter, Virginia, died, followed just over 1 year later by the death of his 14-month-old son, Michilio. 8 months after these two tragedies, his beloved wife, Margherita, died of encephalitis, leaving the distraught maestro to say to himself, "A third coffin goes out of my house. I am alone. Verdi's father-in-law, Antonio Baretti, writes in his diary, "Through a terrible disease, perhaps unknown to the doctors, there died in my arms in Milan at noon on the day of Corpus Domini, my beloved daughter Margherita, in the flower of her years and at the culmination of her good fortune, because married to the excellent youth Giuseppe Verdi, maestro di musica." Verdi allowed himself to be led home to Busseto, and over the next few weeks tried to get his contract with La Scala annulled. Merelli, the head of La Scala, insisted that he fulfill his obligations, and within 2 months, Verdi found himself back in Milan, bringing to completion, then rehearsing, a comic opera buffa. Feeling his creative energies completely exhausted, he followed the compositional style of his predecessors, primarily Donizetti, Rossini, and Mercadante. Listen for a moment to Verdi's buffo writing in this excerpt of recitative and duet between two of the lower male voices in his second opera, Un Giorno di Regno, or King for a Day. Adagio tutto. Parola, cerca qualche pretesto col barone, chissà se voglio intendere la ragione. O cospetto, un sovrano, la principessa esca, le finanze sono tutti pendi di tanta conseguenza, che dovrò finalmente aver pazienza. Singers, two of whom thought it safest to spare their voices at sometimes just mouthing while the orchestra played. Said one critic, they reduced by half the effect of some of the pieces that were perhaps not entirely bad. Ironically, the failure of Un Giorno di Regno in its one performance may have secured the continuation of Verdi's career. La Scala substituted in its place 17 performances of Oberto, and the audiences welcomed it. Although Verdi had sworn never to compose again, through the encouragement and support of his friends, colleagues, and Merelli, the director of La Scala, Verdi moved forward with the composition of his third opera, Nabucco, which would permanently establish his success as a composer until his retirement from the theater some 25 operas later. It's at this time that Giuseppina Strepponi begins to emerge as an important figure in Verdi's life. She had been the leading lady in Oberto, and her stunning performance was credited with much of the success of the opera. Several years later, Strepponi would be influential in convincing Merelli at La Scala to present Nabucco at the earliest opportunity, again with herself as the leading lady. The opera was an instant success, receiving 8 initial performances in the tail end of the first season, and an unprecedented, and since unequal, 57 additional performances the following season. 57 performances. Within 3 years, it had reached Vienna, Lisbon, Barcelona, Berlin, Paris, Hamburg. In 1848, it was heard in New York, and in 1850 in Buenos Aires. One of the most enduring pieces that Verdi ever composed is the Act III chorus of the Hebrew Slaves from Nabucco, Va Pensiero, a powerful, mostly unison hymn of longing for one's homeland. Its message of hope resonated with the Italian peoples and in their hearts affirmed their right to a government suited to their desires and their traditions. It became regularly encored in performances, a practice that continues to this day. Nabucco was at the Met 2 weeks ago on the weekend broadcast. The crowds in the streets of Verdi's funeral procession spontaneously broke into this moving chorus. And as can be seen on YouTube, from a recent performance at the Rome Opera, Maestro Riccardo Muti paused after this chorus to turn to the audience and address then Prime Minister Silvio Berlusconi directly, who was in attendance at the performance, about the importance of funding the arts as a national treasure. Muti said, "Va pensiero in old days was a political symbol. I am not a politician, but I can say that if our culture goes on being slain, our Italia will be si bella e perduta, beautiful and lost." He then invited the entire audience to sing along as the chorus was encored. So, if you would now please find the chorus parts that were included with your program for tonight, we will all have the opportunity to sing under the baton of Maestro Muti. As you locate your music, listen to the translation of the Italian text.
Thank you.
emerge from Verdi's pen was I Lombardi alla prima crociata, the Lombards on the First Crusade, based on an epic poem with a patriotic slant. It premiered at La Scala a mere 11 months after Nabucco, and was Verdi's first opera to be presented in the United States, not at the Met, but at Palmo's Opera House in New York City in 1847. The maestro was entering a period when he would compose operas at an amazing rate, with sometimes only 3 months between premieres of new works. Known as Verdi's early period, beginning with Oberto in 1839, he composed 14 operas over the next 10 years, which he himself described as his years in the galleys, slaving away. On occasion, the demand for his works, the availability or unavailability of a particular cast, or at times the influence of the censors, led to the rewriting of an existing work into something which could then be presented elsewhere. Such is this example from I Lombardi, which was significantly revised 5 years later and presented in a different language and libretto to become Verdi's first grand opera in French. It debuted 5 years later at the Paris Opera under the title of Jérusalem, or Jerusalem. Incidentally, portions of the text of this revision are written in the penmanship of both Verdi and Giuseppina Strepponi, who would eventually become his second wife some 12 years later. Listen now to Pagano's aria from I Lombardi, the angry Sciagurata, hai tu creduto? Wretched woman, did you believe that I could forget you? As nuns sing in the background, a gang of cutthroats agreed to help Pagano capture the leading lady for himself. This aria in Italian from I Lombardi will then be immediately followed by the reworked aria 5 years later from Jerusalem in French. Note the similarities in the character's sentiments, the orchestral themes and rhythms, the phrasing and the melodic line of the singing, the voices between the two arias.
Oh.
opera filled with unbridled passion. But the composer feared the Austrian censors, usually priests and police, who were always on the lookout for those who wrote sexually charged scenes or words, or who wanted to stage political rebellion. Even using the word libertà was considered dangerous. Verdi craftily worked around that. Hernani was followed 8 months later by I Due Foscari, an opera with intense relationships and less spectacle than his previous works. I Due Foscari was followed 4 months later by Giovanna d'Arco, or Joan of Arc. It is reported that Merelli, still the head of La Scala, tried to get the rights from Verdi's publisher directly, cutting Verdi out. And Verdi vowed never again to deal with Merelli or set foot on the stage of La Scala, a vow that he would keep for 36 years until 1881. Giovanna d'Arco was followed 6 months later by Alciera. The plot interested Verdi for the Incas versus conquistadores, political and cultural clashes. Considered by some to be Verdi's worst opera, he himself later wrote that Alciera was proprio brutta. Sounds like ugly. 7 months after Alciera came Attila, or Attila the Hun, to which we shall return in a few moments. 1 year after Attila came Macbeth, which debuted in Florence at the Teatro della Pergola. Second, in the summer, I teach at the Bel Canto Institute in Florence, and we stay in an apartment on the Via della Pergola, less than a block away from this historic theater. So 2 summers ago, while the theater was closed for a renovation, I arranged for our group to have a guided tour. Standing on the stage, it was all empty, a few workmen back there working away, imagining Verdi himself sitting in the pit at the keyboard, as he did on opening night, I was moved to do what?
Sing.
I sang Banquo's aria from Macbeth. However, that was then, this is now, and I'm not going to sing it tonight, as it can be found in the Schirmer-based anthology of opera arias. It is too popular for our purposes tonight. 4 months after Macbeth, Verdi debuted I Masnadieri, or The Robbers, at Her Majesty's Theatre in London. Queen Victoria, Prince Albert, every member of the British aristocracy was there. The press was, for the most part, generous in its praise, although one critic was to describe it as, quote, the worst opera that has been given in our time at Her Majesty's Theatre. Verdi is finally rejected, end quote. Singers, students, take heart. We remember Giuseppe Verdi, not Henry Chorley, who wrote that. Just take a deep breath and keep on doing what it is that you love to do. To that end, the bass aria from I Masnadieri is an excellent aria for a developing bass voice. It is sung by the old Count Massimiliano. We basses always get to sing fathers, priests, or villains. Whose youngest son had intended to bury his father alive in order to gain his inheritance earlier. However, the Count was saved from this ignoble end and deliriously reflects on the horrid events.
Sarà, vi narrò.
Of course I was. I'm trained. Yeah. I don't know what I'm trained for. I was 22.
I after the concert. No, this is intermission. This is just intermission.
Green.
Yeah.
an enraged Verdi eventually withdrew from public performance due to unauthorized changes being made to the score by producers when it was performed in different cities. The opera was abhorred by the censors, who determined that Italian audiences could not be exposed to a story about a married cleric who compels his unfaithful wife to divorce him, and then, shockingly, from the pulpit, publicly forgives her. Stifelio virtually disappeared for 143 years until presented by the Met in 1993 in a new critical edition made from recently rediscovered autograph scores with Plácido Domingo in the title role. Verdi's middle period has only six operas: Luisa Miller, Stifelio, Rigoletto, Il Trovatore, La Traviata, and Le Vespa Sicilienne, all composed in the 6 years between 1849 and 1855. They would become some of the most beloved and oft-performed of his works. As political uprisings swelled and were crushed, and armies swept back and forth across the land, Verdi's nationalistic voice was forced to become subtler than in the rousing choruses of his early period operas. He focused now on individuals longing for acceptance and understanding. No doubt his own personal life, his unmarried relationship with Giuseppe Mascarenhone, and his estrangement from his parents could have all combined to inspire the sensitive situations and vulnerable heroines of Luisa Miller, Rigoletto, Trovatore, Traviata. The libretti for Verdi's operas were of extreme importance to him. He was inspired by authors such as Victor Hugo, Schiller, Scribe, Lord Byron, Alexandre Dumas, Shakespeare, and the Bible. Those works were fashioned into singable prose and poetry by some of the finest Italian and French writers of his time. Soler and Camerano would write five libretti apiece, yet the most important librettist would be Francesco Maria Piave. Piave, who wrote an amazing 15 libretti of Verdi's 28 original operas. One of the few surviving chamber works for voice that Verdi considered worthy of publication is this brief song, Stornello, written in 1869. It's part of a songbook that of original works written by six different composers that was collected by Verdi and published for the benefit of the poet F.M. Piave. The librettist, toward the end of his life, paralyzed and gravely ill, had fallen into an extreme state of poverty, and it was Verdi who championed this initiative to help ensure support for Piave's surviving daughter. Behind the shy and surly facade, Verdi tried to hide his more amiable character, as witnessed by acts of extraordinary generosity and compassion. I wonder if he didn't also have a wry smile on his face while setting to music this country poem on flirtatious love, Stornello.
Costanza dell'amore.
operas of Verdi's middle period are so universally performed and admired that they don't fall under our purview for our study tonight, so we leave them in their glory and popularity. We move to Verdi's late period, 1857 to 1871. It's over this 15-year span we find five more famous and beloved operas: Simone Boccanegra, Un ballo in maschera, La forza del destino, Don Carlos, and Aida. Verdi now had further refined his demanding dramatic requirements and said, quote, I want, in fact, I must have grandiose, impassioned, and original subjects. Musically, Verdi had left behind the formula of the Code Rossini. Perhaps he had heard the rumblings of the composers von Weber and Berlioz, who railed against the Italian habit of writing beautiful music for any and all dramatic situations. Verdi had discovered tinta, color, a term which he used to characterize elements of an individual operatic score, the timbre of different voice types, or of a particular orchestral instrument would portray the emotion or dramatic color that he sought. He was to comment that he had found, quote, the golden thread that binds all the parts together and makes an opera. Tinta, color, was for him this golden thread, the essential unifying factor in each of his later works. Politically, it is during this time that the Italian Risorgimento and its simmering desire for freedom from foreign occupation achieve its goal, unifying the Italian states under King Victor Emmanuel II in 1861. Think of where we were in 1861, where they were in 1861. I found that very interesting. The cry, Viva Verdi, was heard throughout the land, and although it was great recognition for the maestro, it actually was the acronym VIVA, V-E-R-D-I, for Viva Vittorio Emanuele, Re di Italia. In this time of immense jubilation, Verdi allowed himself to be nominated and elected to the new Parliament of the Kingdom of Italy. Now, in his personal life, the maestro, with the still unmarried Giuseppina Strepponi, had returned to the Busseto area for good in 1848 and eventually repurchased the land that his Verdi forebears had occupied for some 300 years. He also purchased more of the surrounding lands, enlarging his farm and built his Villa Verdi at Sant'Agata, about 3 miles outside of Busseto. After years of Giuseppina being shunned by the local Busettari, the couple decided on marriage. They traveled to a small village in the mountains of the Piedmont region, and in 1859, the couple was married with only the coachman who had driven them there and the church bellringer as witnesses. At the end of that year, following the success of Un ballo in maschera, Verdi wrote of his desire to withdraw from composing. And I quote, I have not made any more music. I have not seen any more music. I have not thought about the music. I don't even know what color my last opera is. And I almost don't remember. The maestro did slow his operatic output. And over the 12 years following that quote, composed only La Forza del Destino for St. Petersburg, where they offered him what he always wanted to visit. There's a fabulous picture of him in furs about this thick, freezing there in February. And they offered him a boatload of money. He accepted that. Aida to commemorate the opening of the Suez Canal, and Don Carlos in French for the Paris Opera. The original five-act version of Don Carlos premiered in Paris in 1867. And it was revised some 17 years later into four acts in Italian for La Scala. Although it's the Italian version that we most often hear today, listen now to the famous aria of Philippe, as it was originally sung. Elle ne m'aime pas, she never loved me, is the king's anguished wee hour's reflection on his queen's cold heart. Thank you. Opera Database ranks the international website OperaBase ranks Giuseppe Verdi as the most often performed opera composer of all time. Figures over the last 5 years show Verdi with over 16,000 performances worldwide, followed by Mozart with 11,900 and Puccini with 11,500. La Traviata heads the list, followed by Magic Flute, Carmen, Bohème, Tosca, and Butterfly, with 5 of Verdi's operas in the top 20. In total, Verdi composed 28 operas for 37, if counting all revised editions. And now for tonight's bonus question, which has nothing to do with Verdi, but I thought it was very interesting. And here's a prize for the person who gets the correct answer. A package of Oberpo beef jerky. Truth be told, about 10 days ago, I'm standing in the line at Office Max. Hanging on the end cap there is Oberpo all natural beef jerky. Speaking of all operatic performances, the Germanic countries of Germany, Austria, and Switzerland produce the most total performances of operas, of all operas by far. But the surprise top opera producing city anywhere in the world with the highest number of total operatic performances is... you're my family member. venture a guess?
Moscow.
Moscow! Who said that? Stand up. Here is your Oberpo beef jerky. It was Moscow, followed by Vienna, Berlin, London, St. Petersburg, and at number 9, New York City. Viva Verdi, and enjoy your jerky. The maestro's final period, the 19 years between 1874 and 1893, produced only 3 new operatic works. His magnificent Requiem, which marshaled operatic forces for a spiritual setting, and 2 adaptations of Shakespeare by librettist Arrigo Boito, the operas Otello when Verdi was 74, and Falstaff when he was 79 years old. Look out, George. Okay. A wealthy and famous man, he had retired from politics and withdrawn from public life as much as possible to enjoy walking through his fields of wheat and maize and blue. And to spend time with his beloved Giuseppina. The second Mrs. Verdi sang professionally between the ages of 19 and 31, at which time her voice demanded that she retire from the stage. She became Verdi's constant companion for over 55 years, his champion in matters musical and financial, his muse and confidant. In 1867, when Verdi's father Carlo died, the now 54-year-old Giuseppe and Giuseppina decided to adopt Verdi's little cousin, Maria Verdi, then 7 years old, who had been under the care of Verdi's father. She grew up with them as their own daughter and was later to marry the son of Verdi's friend and lawyer, Angelo Carrara. The Carraras and their descendants eventually became the sole heirs of Verdi's estate and still live in his house, Villa Verdi, to this day. I spoke with Mrs. Carrara when I made arrangements for us to go out there. If you ever get to Italy, sidelight, go visit Busseto. It is absolutely charming. Eden and I rented bicycles and wrote out to be La Verde Santa Agata all over. It was just a phenomenal thing. Following many decades of closed doors, the Carrara family has begun to allow more access to his archives and library at the Villa Verde, leading to exciting new discoveries such as autographs and materials from which critical editions such as Stifelio can be prepared. They discovered also several previously unknown small pieces, and it led to a vast treasure of personal correspondence from which a more complete portrait of the man and his legend can be drawn. Verdi became a philanthropist, of sorts, building a hospital on the edge of his property so people wouldn't have to travel by horse or cart for hours to have a baby or to tend a broken bone. He published a song for earthquake victims in Sicilia and employed 240 workers on his farm. He built the Casa di Riposo per Musicisti in Milan, a home for retired opera singers and musicians, bequeathing all future royalties from his operas to that institution. Verdi was to say, quote, "Of all of my works, that which pleases me the most is the casa that I had built in Milan to shelter elderly singers who have not been favored by fortune, or who, when they were young, did not have the virtue of saving their money. Poor and dear companions of my life." But Verdi was not done yet. Following the success of Otello, he commented, "After having relentlessly massacred so many heroes and heroines, I have at last the right to laugh a little." Initially beginning in secrecy, he and librettist Arrigo Boito began to fashion Shakespeare's lovable fat knight, Sir John Falstaff, into his final opera, of which he would soon exclaim, "What a joy to say to the public, here we are again, come and see us." The premiere of Falstaff took place at La Scala in 1893, when the maestro was 79 years old. For the first night, official ticket prices were 30 times higher than usual. Current day equivalent, perhaps as high as $14,000 per ticket. The performance was a huge success. Numbers were encored, and at the end, the applause for Verdi and the cast lasted an hour. Peppino died in 1901 at age 87 and is buried in the crypt of his Casa di Riposo in Milan. On the occasion, Va Pensiero from Nabucco was conducted by Arturo Toscanini with a chorus of 820 singers. A huge crowd was in attendance, estimated at 300,000. They celebrated the life of a private, reclusive man who, to the end, wrote beautiful, exciting, passionate music. A generous, common man who had his own version of faith and who wrote of honor. From Falstaff, here in an English translation by Walter Duclos from the Shakespearean sources, is Sir John's ironic honor.
I have to hide my girl.
ankle.
Oh, no.
A finger.
No.
A toenail.
No.
A whisker.
No. For honor is no surgery. What is it? Only a word. This word, what is it really?
Oh,